Am I audible?
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
yes, sir.
Okay. So now let us start our class. First of all, I shall show you or the syllabus of this part of the subject. And I am giving you some time. You just take down the syllabus. Though the recording and the class notes will be sent to you, but it is better to write down the syllabus or have the syllabus, entire syllabus of this portion. So let me present it to you. Can you see this, or should I enlarge it slightly? Can you see the syllabus?
Yes,
Yes, sir,
sir.
we can see it.
So just please take down. After 5 minutes, we shall start discussions. Please tell me when you have finished.
Yes, sir, done.
Done.
So 1 minute.
Okay.
So now it's done.
Okay, next part, this one. Have you finished?
Yes, sir.
You tell me. Okay. Now let us go to the first chapter, that is the advantages of high voltage transmission that we shall discuss today. So for that, new slides are required to be done, presented. Just a minute. So, this is our first chapter, that is the chapter on advantages of high voltage transmission, or advantages of high voltage power transmission and distribution. Now, what happens actually, now the generating stations, as the first point mentioned, it is not really possible to locate the generating station and the load consuming centers or load centers close to each other. Usually what happens, the distance between the generating station and the load centers are quite far off, and you have to carry power from generating station to the load end through a quite long a distance. As a result, it is always preferred that the more power can be transmitted from generating station to load center, and the losses while doing or while transmitting the power should be as low as possible. Now, the reason behind the location of the generating station and or the distance between the generating station and the load centers being more or quite long is can be explained like this. Usually, even now, even today, the mostly the power is generated through thermal power generation mechanism, or in some cases it is hydel, or few percentage of power, not much, is generated from other sources like nuclear power, solar power, hydel power, etc. But the major contribution to power is done by thermal power generations. Again, the thermal power stations are located in some places where the availability of coal for burning to be for use in furnaces has to be more, is coal should be easily available, and also after coal fire the ashes that are produced should be washed out. So normally the power station, thermal power stations, are located or in thermal power stations are installed near the river banks or on the river bank, so that the ashes that are developed can be very easily washed out. Similarly, the hydel power stations are located in where the water head is available in order to rotate the turbine blades with the help of water jets, or that is letting water fall on the thermal, turbine blades from a height. So these are the location, these are the reasons why the distance between the thermal power, power stations and the load centers are quite long. Similarly, again, another point you should take into account, that is power transmission using three-phase system is always advantageous, because if instead of three-phase system, we would have used three single-phase systems, then the number of conductors that would have required would have been six. The number of conductor requirements would have been six in the case of three single phase systems. But in the case of three phase systems, the number of conductor requirements is four. And also the neutral wire, if the system is balanced, carries very little current or theoretically no current if it is perfectly balanced system. So the neutral wire, its cross section, etc., will be relatively thin compared to the phase conductors. So these are the reasons why three-phase power is actually transmitted. And now let us see why power transmission at high voltage level is always economical. Why that is economical, that let us see. So at here we are considering a very simple three-phase four-wire system. Actually, in this case, the transmission loss is equal to 3 into I square into R, where I is the current per phase and R is the resistance per phase. That is the total transmission loss in three phases. And here, X is normally a declared fraction, which is equal to permitted fraction of transmission loss. And it is defined by the power loss under rated load to the power supplied. That is rated power supply. That is under rated load condition, power loss divided by rated power supply. That is the fraction x, and normally for a particular system this fraction is mentioned. What should be the permitted power loss under rated load condition? Therefore, and total power that is transmitted is equal to 3 V phase I phase cos phi, that is well known expression, or root 3 VLIL cos phi, that we all know. Then the transmission loss is 3 I square R, that is 3 IL square into R, that is 3 into P square by this. From here we can write down the expression for IL in terms of P, and substituting that here we can finally get this expression. Do you understand this or not? You tell me. Up to this, that is P square into rho into L by A V L square cos square phi.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if that is understood, then we go to the next slide. You see, note that here L is the length of the transmission line and A is the cross-sectional area of the line as usual. From the above expression, we can find X as follows. X, as we have defined, transmission loss divided by rated power. So transmission loss, in the previous slide, we have found the expression, that is P square into rho into L by A divided by VL square cos square phi. So that divided by P rated power, that is your X. So X is can be finally written as equal to P into rho into L divided by A into VL square cos square phi. Let that be our equation one. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just a minute, let me see whether recording is going on or not. Yes, it is going on. Okay, then now the volume of copper is equal to 3 into A into L, A being the cross-sectional area and L being the length. So conductor, transmission conductors are of the form of cylinders. So cross-sectional area into L will give you the volume. That multiplied by 3 for the 3 conductors is equal to the volume of the copper. That can now be written as equal to 3 into P into rho into L square. This is A. So 3 into L is equal to this. That can be obtained from this expression. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, from the above expression, what we can conclude? Actually, the volume of copper, it is clear that the transmission voltage, if VL is increased, then the volume of copper decreases and thereby the cost of the copper is reduced, and thus the system economy is improved, that we can say. Therefore, it is always advantageous to transmit power at high voltages or high voltage level. Because with the increase in voltage, we find that the volume of copper requirement will reduce, thereby the expenditure or the cost of copper will decrease, improving the system economy. Is that okay? Do you understand this point? Here, VL is at the denominator, so the more will be the value of VL, less will be the volume of copper. Is it okay? Do you understand this point?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then what are the other advantages of in power transmission in at increased voltage level? So there are few. With the increase in transmission voltage, the size of the conductor is reduced, that we have seen. Next point is, for the same power to be transmitted, with the increase in transmission voltage, obviously, if the magnitude of the power or the amount of power to be transmitted remains constant, then with the increase in voltage, what will happen to the magnitude of current? That will be reduced because it is root 3 VLIL cos phi. So if VL increases, P remains same, IL has to reduce. And if the magnitude of the current decreases, then I square R loss, that also decreases. So that is another advantage. Now, low current at higher voltages reduces the line drop of, that is, if the magnitude of the current decreases, not only the loss, I square R loss, but also the IR drop, that will also decrease. And what will happen at the sending end, or at at the receiving end, that is the load end, you will get more voltage, since the drop taking place over the transmission conductor is being decreased. Therefore, better voltage regulation you will get with increased voltage level of power transmission. Is that okay, this point? Better voltage regulation is this point?
Yes, sir.
Okay, next point is, at higher voltages, line losses are reduced and hence transmission efficiency is improved. Obviously, if the losses decrease, then transmission efficiency will increase. Next, the advantage is, with higher voltages, the insulation requirement is more. These are the limitations of increasing system voltage. So just now we have seen power transmission at increased voltage level provides us with number of advantages, but even then we cannot increase the transmission level voltage indiscriminately, because there are other restrictions which actually limits the increase in voltage indiscriminately. The first thing is this: with the increase in voltage, obviously the insulation requirement of the system will increase. Now, if the cost of increased insulation cost, if the increased insulation cost compensates fully the gain obtained due to reduction in copper volume, then there is no point in increasing the voltage up to that level. So that is one disadvantage. Now, next is this: as you increase the voltage, the clearance from the ground with the phase conductors has to be increased. So if you have to increase the clearance between the phase conductor and the ground more and more, then you have to go for taller tower structures. Now, if you go for taller tower structures, or if you increase the height of the tower, then what will happen? Cost of the tower will be more. Soumitra Rudra. Soumitra Rudra, you have just now joined the class. The class was scheduled from 7:30. You have joined almost 40 minutes late. Why? Please respond.
Sir, I'm extremely sorry, sir. I just forgot the timing. Sir, I remembered it till 7 a.m. After that, I don't know how I forgot. Sorry, sir.
So you leave your mobile number with me after the class, so that I can give you a reminder before every class.
No, sorry, sir. Extremely sorry. I will be on time from next class.
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry, sir.
Now, the next point is, with the increase in transmission voltage, normally the transmission conductors are suspended from the tower cross arms, and a clearance between the transmission conductors and tower body is maintained. Now, if the voltage, transmission level voltage, is increased, then it is required that the clearance between the transmission conductors and tower body should be more. Thereby, the cross arm, length of the tower cross arm, which actually supports or which actually hangs the transmission conductors, should be more. And if the length of the tower cross arm increases, then the tower becomes even costlier. So these are the reasons for which, even with the increase in voltage, though we get certain advantages, we cannot increase the voltage indiscriminately. Now, this is one curve which actually explains how we can find out the optimum voltage level. This is the copper cost volt. This curve is for the copper cost, and this is the insulation cost. And the intersection of this, where the copper cost and insulation cost is equal, if you add these two together, then you will get this is the total cost. And the intersection, though the in the diagram it is not correctly drawn, the optimum operating voltage will be where the insulation cost and copper cost are more or less same. Or otherwise, you can determine it like this: you plot the copper cost, you plot the insulation cost, which varies linearly with the length of the transmission line, then adding these two costs together graphically, you plot the transmission, total cost, and the point which provides the minimum cost, that is the the voltage corresponding to that point provides you or gives you the optimum voltage. Just a minute. Now, there is another empirical formula which is like this, which also gives you the optimum operating voltage V is equal to root over of L plus load in KVA. Load in KVA divided by 150, and the whole thing is expressed in KV, where L is the length of the transmission line in kilometer. Next, we shall discuss advantages of DC high voltage transmission. But before that, if you have any question up to this, that is up to the point, finding out the optimum operating voltage and the advantages of high voltage AC transmission or power transmission in high voltage at the high voltage level, if you have any question, you can ask me. Otherwise, we shall discuss advantages of high voltage DC transmission. So, do you have any question?
No, sir.
So, these are, I think, recapitulations. You have already studied all these things in your power system classes, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Mostly. Major part of the syllabus may be repetition, but again, everything will be discussed in with the view to high voltages, transmission, distribution, etc. Now, so consider, let us now consider the advantages of DC high voltage transmission. There are so many advantages, but the major advantages we shall discuss here. In DC transmission, there is a saving in insulation cost as peak and RMS values are identical. That is, in the case of AC transmission system, though the power is transmitted at the RMS voltage level, but the insulation has to be provided for peak voltages. That is, root 2 times of RMS voltage level, you have to provide the insulation. But in the case of DC RMS average, everything is same peak RMS average. That is why you don't have to use extra insulation level in DC as it is in the case of AC. So that is the first advantages. Now, for the same peak stress, there is more corona loss and radio interference in AC transmission than in DC transmission. So, in DC, corona loss is less and radio interference is also less than in AC. What is corona loss, etc., we shall discuss in the next chapter or next chapter. Third point is, when power is transmitted through cables, DC transmission is always preferred. Yes, because in AC, you know there is a continuous charging current present in the case of AC. But in the case of DC, once the capacitor, charging current is the current flowing through the capacitors to charge them. When we go for underground cables, always some capacitance is formed compared to the transmission lines. The capacitance in the case of underground cables is more. Therefore, the charging current is more in the case of cables than in the case of overhead transmission. Now, when AC is passed through the cables, what happens? Continuous charging current exists, but in the case of DC transmission, after the capacitors are fully charged, no further current flows through the capacitor. That is why charging current will be less in the case of DC than in AC. So in the case of cable transmission, this is the reason why DC is always preferred. In DC, there is no skin effect involved, that you already know. And in the case of AC, power transmission is limited by the power angle alpha. Sometimes it is also expressed by delta, and that is the angle between the sending end and receiving end voltage. And do you know the expression for power transmitted in terms of sending end and receiving end voltage and their capacitances, inductances, etc.?
Yes, sir, the approximate formula.
What is that?
The active power is the sending end voltage Vs into receiving end voltage by X into X, and the total is multiplied with sine delta. Delta right. Is the load angle.
That is the active power. So it is dependent not only on the sending end and receiving end voltage, but system reactance and sine delta. Delta is sometimes referred to as the load angle. That is the angle between the sending end and receiving end voltage. But in the case of DC, no such load angle exists because the entire drop is resistive drop. So the sending end and receiving end voltage, they remain always in phase with each other. So that disadvantage is also not there in the case of DC transmission. A DC line requires no reactive compensation because there is no continuous either capacitive charging current, and inductance is also absent in DC. Similarly, no synchronous operation is required in DC system. But in the case of AC system, whenever you want to connect a new AC system in the existing one, you have to synchronize them. Otherwise, you cannot just put the new system in any interconnected system without synchronizing. And this is another advantage. A DC link is often used to interconnect two AC systems at different frequencies. Yes, if we have two different AC systems operating at different frequencies, then to interconnect them, we can use a DC link. That is, in one end, the voltage is inverted, and the other end, it is converted. And in between, there is a DC link which serves the purpose of interconnecting them. So these are the major advantages of high voltage DC transmission, but there, even though the high voltage DC transmission provides so many advantages, the high voltage DC transmission has not become very popular even today. What is the reason? Can anybody say this? Or why high voltage DC transmission is not very popular even today? Can anybody say this?
Sir, cost is higher.
Why cost is higher?
Sir, the AC voltage can be easily step up and step down basically, but DC voltage requires power electronic devices which are costly comparatively.
Yes, stepping up, stepping up, down, you have explained it in that connection. Yes, it is true, but there are other two major disadvantages. One is what you have said, there is one more, that is more important. Now you see, actually, if we have a HVDC transmission line, and these are the two AC, DC transmission line, and these are the two AC systems, which are interconnected with the help of this high voltage DC transmission line. Now, what all we have to do this, we have to rectify the AC voltage on one end, and we have to invert it on the other end. So this conversion needs rectifying and inverting equipments, which increase the system cost, these solid state devices. And also this conversion requires large megavolt amperes, and they introduce harmonics in the system. So that is one disadvantage, or that is one reason why DC voltage or DC transmission is not so popular even today. Now, there is another major disadvantage. What is that? You must be knowing what is circuit breaker. Have you not studied circuit breakers in detail, I know. But do you have any idea what is basically a circuit breaker?
Yes, sir.
What is that?
Sir, a circuit breaker actually protects the circuit when fault occurs in that system. So.
Yes, how it protects?
A relay senses the fault, and according to the relay, the circuit breaker opens, circuit breaker
actually,
terminals.
Yes, that is all right. Basically, circuit breaker is a sophisticated switch which makes or breaks the circuit under the direction of the relay, which senses the power system fault and sends a signal either to trip or reconnect the circuit breaker. Either a trip signal is sent or reconnecting signal is sent to connect the circuit. So now a circuit breaker is nothing but a sophisticated switch. Now any switch, maybe it is a switch operating a fan, switch for making a fan on or off, or any other switch which is used in our daily and domestic household purposes. Now, if you carefully look, when you make the switch, or when you use the switch to make a running fan off, a small spark occurs inside the switch. Or also, when you use the switch to make the fan on, then also another small spark occurs between the poles of the switches. Now, so far as the fan or other domestic equipments are concerned, the current that is dealt with or current involved while making it on or off is much less compared to the current that has to be handled by a circuit breaker while making the system on or off. Therefore, the spark that will be occurring between the poles of a circuit breaker will be much more compared to the spark that occurs between the poles of a common household switch. Is the point clear? Or not? Why the spark occurs, etc.? Is it clear or not?
Can you repeat it, sir?
Whenever, suppose there is a circuit which is under on condition, suppose the fan is running, suddenly you, with the help of the switch, you are making it off, then what are you doing? You are cutting or bringing the current in that circuit from a certain value to suddenly to a zero value. In that case, the energy that was associated in the circuit comes down to zero, how it will come to zero? It has to release the energy that is released in the form of light and heat, that is the spark. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
In the case of circuit breaker, since the amount of current that is dealt with by the circuit breaker is much higher than that in the case of domestic household switches, then what will happen? What will happen? The magnitude of the spark will be much more compared to the switch that is operating a fan. Is that okay? The energy involved in that case, in the case of circuit breaker, is much more compared to the normal common household switches.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, it has always been attempted that while breaking any circuit by the circuit breaker, the energy that has to be tackled should be as low as possible. Now, the nature of AC voltages and currents, they provide this advantage that we all know that the AC voltages and currents, they crosses the natural zero values quite number of times in every cycle, depending upon the frequency. But at least, whatever may be the frequency, at least in a complete cycle, how many zero crossings are there for AC voltages and currents? At least two. One in one half cycle, it is two. In complete cycle, it will be three.
Three.
Okay. So there are three zero crossings. And when the magnitude of the current passes through the zero value, then the associated energy in the circuit at that instant of time or near that instant of time is very low. In the case of AC circuit breakers, the mechanism is such that the circuit is opened by the circuit breaker when the current passes through its natural zero value, so that the associated energy that has to be dealt with will be very low. So that is an advantage of AC system. But in the case of DC system, the DC voltage or current never comes down to zero. You have to have certain special mechanisms so that you can bring down the magnitude of the current to zero value, and then the circuit breaker can operate. And this mechanism, it's very difficult to develop. Not only that, it will be a very costly type of thing. That is why DC circuit breakers are very difficult to develop. And due to this restriction or limitation, basically, the DC transmission, high voltage DC transmission, is not that popular even today. Is that okay? Is the point clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is there any other question up to this, or otherwise we shall take up the next topic, that is insulators. Is there any question?
No, sir.
Okay. Next, let us then consider the insulators. Now, there are two ways of power transmission. One is overhead and the other is underground cables. Now, overhead transmission system is always preferred because it is economical, since the main insulation is air, and at the transmission towers or at some places, there are porcelain and glass insulations. So, since the main insulations, the transmission conductors are not insulated. Bare conductors run between the towers, and starting from the generating station to the load, no other insulation is required. So that provides a major advantage for overhead transmission line, and that That is why overhead power transmission is always preferred compared to the underground cables. But so far as the underground cables are concerned, they are also used in some places where it is necessary, especially in cities and densely populated areas. It is not really possible to transmit power or distribute power through overhead transmission lines. In those cases, power is transmitted, not really transmitted, distributed through underground cables. That we shall take up separately. Now, so far as the insulators are concerned, few definitions are very much required. In this semester, you have high voltage lab, I think. This is your second semester, na? This is second semester, na? Third year, second semester?
Yes, sir.
In first semester, what are the experiments you performed on in high voltage?
So breakdown strength of solid and liquid insulating materials.
And high voltage, high AC voltage measurement, isn't it? Using spear gap.
No, sir.
So only one experiment?
Two experiments. One is breakdown strength of liquid insulating materials and breakdown strength of solid insulating materials. These two.
Solid insulating material. That is kraft paper and enameled wire.
Yes, sir.
And in liquid transformer oil.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in this semester, you will study one experiment. Two experiments. One is the measurement of high AC voltage, and the second one is power frequency withstand and flashover test of pin insulators. So this we will study, and there in this experiment, power frequency withstand and flashover test of pin insulator, you have to study certain physical parameters of the insulator, which will involve measuring creepage distance and protected creepage distances, etc. Now, creepage distance, by the term creepage distance, what is meant is the shortest path between two conductive parts, that is the high voltage conductor and the earth conductor, between which an insulator is placed. That is called the creepage distance, measured along the contours of the external surface of the insulation. So it is the shortest distance between the conductor, between the two conductive parts, and it is measured along the surface or the contours of the external surface of the insulation. Protected creepage distance we shall discuss, but let us first see the diagram and explain the creepage distance. Now suppose this is a pin type insulator, which is here, it is the earth pin, and this is the structure of the insulator. It is normally made up of porcelain, sometimes glass insulators are also used. And this is the high voltage conductor placed at the top groove of the insulator. So this is the high voltage conductor, and through this earth pin, it is placed at the tower cross arm. And since the tower is at ground potential, therefore, this earth pin will be also at ground potential. So this is high voltage conductor and this is the earth. So these are the two conducting parts. So the total distance measured along the external surface of the insulator, starting from the high voltage conductor up to the earth conductor or earth electrode, whatever you call it, that distance gives you the creepage distance. What is the significance of this creepage distance? Now, in spite of our best efforts, we cannot make perfect insulators. Therefore, always there is some leakage current present in any insulating system. And leakage current is the current which flows from the high voltage conductor or live conductor to the ground conductor, not through the body of the insulating material, but along its outer surface. So this length provides the length through which or over which the leakage current will flow. Obviously, the more will be this length, the less will be the value of the leakage current. So this length which gives you the length for flow of leakage current is your creepage distance. Tell me whether it is clear to you all or not.
Yes, sir.
Okay, then let us discuss protected creepage distance. Now, the part of the creepage distance on the illuminated side of the insulator, which would lie in shadow if light were projected onto the insulator in a direction at 90 degree to the longitudinal axis of the insulator, is called protected creepage distance. Definition, I repeat, the part of the creepage distance on the illuminated side of the insulator which would lie in shadow if the light were projected onto the insulator in a direction at 90 degree to the longitudinal axis of the insulator is called protected creepage distance. Again, let us see the diagram. Here, suppose this, the longitudinal axis will be like this, vertical axis to the center of the earth pin and the insulator. Now, if light rays are allowed to fall, making an angle of 90 degree from this side on the insulator surface, these are the insulator surface, I mean portion of the insulator surface, which will lie in shadow. That will not be illuminated. Is that okay? These portions, the inside
yes,
portions, they will remain in shadow. They will not be illuminated. So sum total of the such distances which lie in shadow is called the protected creepage distance. Now, what is the significance of this protected creepage distance? Let us now discuss that. Actually, what happens, you see, these insulators are mostly used in outdoor service conditions. And they undergo different types of atmospheric conditions. In the case of rains and strong winds, what happens, water particles fall on the insulator surface and the insulator surface gets wet, and under normal operating condition, since they are placed at the outdoor, some dust particles accumulate on the insulator outer insulator surface, and when rain drops or water drops fall on the insulator surface, those dust particles mixing with the water droplets develops a low resistance path for the flow of leakage current. Now, it is not necessary that always the raindrops will fall vertically or parallel to the longitudinal axis of the insulator on the outer or exposed surface of the insulators. Depending upon the direction of wind, the water particles or water drops may fall on the external surfaces, making certain angle. But whatever may be the angle, this angle will never be around 90 degrees. Now, the protected creepage distance gives you that direction, that distance, which will not get wet even if the raindrops fall with an angle of 90 degree to the longitudinal axis. So that part will not produce or provide low resistance path for the flow of leakage current. That part will remain dry. So sum total of such distances is your protected creepage distance. Is this clear? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Breakdown of insulators. Again, these two things are also, I think, known to you. There are two methods of breakdown. One is flashover and second is puncture. Now, flash over or spark over of the insulation surface is not really a failure of the insulating material or of the insulator. It is really a ionization of the adjacent air. Flash over or spark over the insulation surface through the adjacent air, connecting those parts, or practically speaking, connecting those conductors which normally have the operating voltages between them. So it is really a ionization of the air adjacent to the outer surface or exposed surface of the insulator. And normally it takes place between the two conductors which have the operating voltage between them. If you go back to the diagram, here, this is one conductor, this is another conductor. So the flashover will take place along this path. That is ionization of air, and between the two parts having the operating voltage between them, but it is not really a failure of the insulating material of the insulator. Flashover is the breakdown of the surrounding air, and that is, since it is not the failure of the insulating material of the insulator, it is not really a permanent failure, and the insulator can be used when flashover stops. That is an important point. Flashover is not a permanent failure, and the insulator can be used when the flashover stops. But however, repeated flashover causes a mark along the insulator surface or along the insulator surface of the insulator called tracking, that makes a weaker surface prone to breakdown. Actually, what happens if any insulator is subjected to repeated flashovers, then what happens? A part of the insulator surface, exposed external insulator surface, gets burned, and a mark, basically a burning mark and development of corona. The development of carbon is seen on the insulator surface, external insulator surface. And since due to burning out of the insulating material, carbons are actually due to electrochemical breakdown of the insulating material, carbons develop on the external surface. Low resistance path is provided by the insulator under that condition. And these marks, these flashover marks, or this phenomenon is called tracking. And when tracking occurs and permanent mark of carbon develops on the insulator surface, external surface, that insulator is prone to failure. They fail after some days or some time when they are in use. But on the other hand, after one or two flashovers, if the reason for flashover is actually checked and controlled, then the insulator is not damaged and that insulator can be reused. Next one is your puncture. Puncture is a breakdown of the solid insulating material between the high voltage conductor and the grounded part. And this puncture is the failure of the insulator through the body of the insulator. Again, going back to the diagram, when puncture develops, failure takes place through the insulating material between the high voltage conductor and the earth pin. Now, since this puncture takes place through the insulating material, it is a permanent type of failure, because whenever puncture takes place, a low resistance path develops through the body of the insulator, and whenever high voltage is applied to the high voltage conductor, majority of the current starts flowing, or a huge amount of current starts flowing through the short circuited path or the path that has been developed due to puncture through the body of the insulator, starting from the high voltage conductor up to the earth conductor or earth electrode. Therefore, the whole purpose of providing the insulator is lost. That is why whenever puncture occurs in any insulator, that is a permanent type of failure, since current flows through the body of the insulator, and that insulator is no longer used, and that is why deliberately the insulators are so designed that the flashover voltage is lower than the puncture voltage. That is, if flashover occurs, that indicates there is some abnormality in the system, and when that the reason behind the flashover is removed, then the system again works satisfactorily. Is there any question up to that, up to this part?
Sir, why the flashover voltage is less than the puncture voltage?
Now, you see, the flashover we have discussed and we have explained that it is not really a permanent failure, neither it is the failure of the insulating material, unless there are repeated flashovers and cracking is developed. If only one and two flashover occurs and proper care is taken so that the flashover does not take place further, then the insulator is not getting damaged.
Is it okay?
Because it is really a failure or ionization of the surrounding air. It is not really a failure of the insulator, insulator or insulating material of the insulator. But what happens in the case of puncture? A short-circuited path is created through the body of the insulator or through the volume of the insulator, insulating material of the insulator, between the two conducting parts, that is the high voltage electrode and earth electrode. So if a short circuiting path is created through the insulator itself, then leakage current will always flow through that part, through that path, bridging up the two electrodes. And the more the leakage current will be, the more heat generation through the insulating material will be there, and more carbon particles will be developed and making a complete short circuit between the high voltage electrode and earth electrode. So it is really a permanent type of failure. You cannot reuse that insulator when puncture occurs. Therefore, that is the reason why deliberately the flashover voltage is kept lower than the puncture voltage, so that the flashover can take place before the occurrence of puncture. And once the flashover takes place, everybody understands that there is some problem in the system. And when that problem is taken care of, then the system, system normalcy can be restored without the development of any flashover, and thus the insulator can be used. But if the other thing would have been done, that is the puncture voltage would have been made lower or less than the flashover voltage, then the puncture will occur before any flashover, and then that insulator cannot be used. You have to shut down the system for some time. You have to replace the insulator. That is why intentionally the flashover voltage is kept lower than the puncture voltage.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now, again, can you see this diagram? Let me enlarge it slightly. You see, here there are, actually this diagram shows you three paths to the three dotted lines. A is the leakage path, the creepage distance, etc. Leakage path, same as the creepage distance. B is the dry flashover path. And C is the wet flashover path. What is dry flashover path? dry flashover path B indicates the path through which the air will ionize, or along which ionization of air will take place when there is no rain. So this is the length of the dry flashover path, B. But in the case of wet flashover path during rain, when the outer surfaces of the insulator are mixed, the dust particles accumulated on the insulator surface gets accumulated with the water, etc., then what happens? What will happen? Then really, the flashover will take place partially through air and partially through along the insulator surface. And the length of the flashover path is less than the length of the dry flashover path. Here it will come along air up to this point. From here it will make a jump, come on the insulator surface, and along the insulator surface it will complete its rest of the path. But in the case of dry flashover, the entire path is along air, and that is why it is much larger. So this is the condition. During dry condition, the flashover takes place only through the shortest air path, whereas in wet condition, it would be partly through air path and partly through wet and conducting insulator surface. That is what we have been discussing. That is, in the during dry condition, the flashover takes place only through the shortest air path, whereas in wet condition it would be partly through air path and partly through wet and conducting insulator surface. Wet flashover voltage is smaller than the dry flashover voltage due to smaller leakage path. That is important point. Wet flashover voltage is lower than the dry flashover voltage. Is that okay? Is it okay, or do I need any more explanation, or do I need to explain it once again? Do you understand this dry flashover and wet flashover? Or should I repeat it?
Sir, understood.
Understood.
Sir, dry flashover will have lesser path.
Which one?
Dry flashover.
No. You see, can you see this diagram?
Yes, sir.
Dry flashover will take place entirely through the air, but wet flashover will take place partially through air, say for example up to this point. Then it will make a jump, come onto the conductor, insulator surface, external surface, where it will find a low resistance path due to mixing up of water droplets and the dust particles. So it will follow the external path, it will follow the path through the external surface of the insulator up to this point, and then through these paths. So this, the length of this part is much less compared to the length here. That is why the length of the dry flashover path is more than the length of the wet flashover path. And because the length of the wet flashover path is less than the dry flashover path, therefore the voltage at which wet flashover will occur is less than the voltage at which dry flashover takes place.
Okay, sir.
Okay, then. Now, insulating material. Now, this part you just quickly go through. Is a descriptive, this is a descriptive one and needs no explanation. So you just go through it, and when it is done, you tell me. Then we shall discuss the advantages of toughened glass insulator.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now the advantages of glass insulators over porcelain. Now toughened glass insulators possesses greater mechanical strength, and therefore there is less breakage in transport and installation. So that is one point. They have high thermal shock resistance, and therefore damage from flashover is less. Obviously, if it can withstand more thermal shock, then chance of damage due to flashover will be less. The toughened glass insulators have greater puncture strength. That is obviously advantageous, because the more will be the puncture strength, the probability of longer use of that insulator is more. It will be prone to less failure. And next point is the life of a toughened glass insulator is also more. So these are the major advantages of glass insulators over the porcelain insulators. But the cost of porcelain, I mean glass insulator, is slightly more than the porcelain insulators. Glass insulators are slightly more costly than the porcelain insulators. Next is the type of insulators. Now there are many types of insulators, but so far as the high voltage is concerned, these four types of insulators we shall discuss: pin insulators, disc insulators, suspension insulators, and strain insulators. Other than these types of insulators, post insulators are often used in high voltage system. So pin insulators, disc insulators, suspension insulators, strain insulators, and post insulators. These are the five different types of insulators which we shall discuss. Now let us start with pin insulators. Now pin insulator is supported on forged steel pin or bolt, which is secured to the supporting structure. Now this is the diagram of pin insulator. This is the pin through which it is placed at the tower cross arm or in the tower, I mean, or in that supporting structure, I should say. Now, there are two figures. One is one-piece insulator, and the other is, this is two-piece insulators. You see, this is the top group where the live conductor is placed, and through the pin, it is placed on the supporting structure, maybe tower or something else. But whatever may be the supporting structure, through the pin, it is grounded. Now these groups are provided for accommodating the binding wires. So they are called the binding wire groups. And what is the requirement of these binding wires? Because if you just place the live conductor onto this top groove and leave it as it is without properly binding it, then a strong wind may displace it from its position and it may come in contact with any of the earth objects and thereby a direct or dead short circuit may occur. That is why after placing the live conductor on the top groove through the binding wires, they are securely or tightly placed here, and these are the grooves which accommodate the binding wires. Now these projected sections of the insulators are called the rain sheds. Okay, now going back to this, the straight line conductor is tied to the top groove by binding wires which get their support through the side groove that is provided. Binding wire groove we have just now seen. Single piece type pin insulators are used for lower voltages, but for higher voltages two or more pieces are connected together to provide sufficient thickness of porcelain and adequate creepage path. Is that point clear? Single piece type of pin insulator, etc.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, pin type insulators, are used for system voltages less than or equal to 33 kV. Beyond 33 kV, pin insulators become uneconomical. Right? Next is your disc insulator. Now, this is the disc type of insulator. This is the live electrode. There is a metallic cap, and this is the groove for accommodating the live electrode. And this is the high voltage electrode. Actually, what really happens, single piece pin disc insulators are rarely used. Usually, number of disc insulators are joined together. That is, this high voltage electrode is inserted into the top cap of the next disc insulator, and in this way, a number of discs are joined together to form a suspension insulator or string of suspension insulators. The topmost insulator in the string is supported from the tower cross arm. That is, the top top cap of the topmost insulator is at ground potential, and this lower end of the lowermost disc insulator in the string supports the high voltage conductors. Normally in an 11 kV, an 11 kV disc insulator have a height of 16 to 18 centimeter and diameter of 28 to 29 centimeters. To withstand higher voltage, a number of such discs are connected in series to provide higher voltage insulation. Next will be your suspension insulators. Here, this is the creepage length, etc., as before. Now, I think suspension insulators and other things we shall discuss in the next class. Now, before that, let me find out who are here in the class till at the end, and let me call the roll numbers. Now, you tell me how many students are there in your class, in your section.